By derivation, suppose you derive a string W, then this is called leftmost derivation. If we apply a production only to the leftmost variable in each and every step, we apply the production of the leftmost variable. Similarly, just a minute. Similarly, if in the derivation, only the rightmost variable is chosen for the next obtaining for the next step, then you call it as a rightmost derivation. So, in the slide, I am showing you a derivation. So, if you observe the derivation, the derivation has started here and it has ended in some string. So, the string is this. So, if you look at this, see this step, this is the rightmost variable. We have two S to AAS. So, one of the S productions is chosen. The grammar I am considering is this S to AAS and A productions. So, if you look at this, there are two variables, but I am taking the rightmost variable, yes. And in the next step, you have three variables and the rightmost S is chosen, and another step, the next step, the next step, the next step. If you keep on look at this, if you keep on looking at this, then you always see that rightmost variable is chosen and ultimately you get a string. So what happens now? So, what you get is a rightmost derivation, because rightmost variable is chosen at each and every step. So, the condition should be satisfied that at any step you take, the rightmost variable must be chosen. And similarly, you look at this derivation, the derivation which I have shown at the bottom. So, now the leftmost variable is chosen, the same string, I have derived the same string. In the step, each and every step, you can see that leftmost variable, among all the variables, this is whatever you get intermediate is called sentential form. In each sentential form, in the derivation of the string, in each step, we have or we are choosing the leftmost variable. We are choosing the leftmost variable and we are arriving at the derivation. So, and this is your derivation tree. If you look at the derivation tree for this is this and for this also is this. So, either you can show a derivation using a derivation tree or some derivation, or you can have a rightmost derivation, or you can also have a leftmost derivation. Then based on this, we have something called as ambiguity in context-free grammars. So, if you take a context-free grammar G, if there, it's called ambiguous if there exists. That means there exists always something called as at least one string should be there. It need not be true for all the strings, but you can find at least one string. So if there exists some string W belongs to L of G, that is this language generated by the grammar. So this, in this grammar, you can find one string for which you will have two or more left derivations. That means at least two or more. So there must be more than one leftmost derivation, or there must be more than one rightmost derivation, or you have more than one derivation tree, different derivation trees. It can satisfy any one of these. If one is there, then other ones obviously will be there. So saying these three statements is equal. So either you can say two or more leftmost derivations, it implies that there will be two or more rightmost derivations, and it implies that you can have two or more rightmost derivations and two or more rightmost different derivation trees, right? So if this is the case, then we say that the grammar is ambiguous. Look at the grammar. The grammar I have given is S to S plus S, only one variable, and we have four productions. This grammar is a very well-known grammar. Usually we'll call it as expression grammar, which will give you arithmetic expressions. I am showing you only two expressions, plus and star, and two terminals, A, B, plus star, four terminals, right? Now you can see the string A plus A star B, the string A plus A star B is derived using the leftmost derivation. This is your leftmost derivation. This is one leftmost derivation and this is another leftmost derivation. You can see these two derivations are different, but they are giving you the same string. So there is at least one string. So for one string I have shown, so it is sufficient that there exists a string. So similarly, you can see two rightmost derivations. There are two rightmost derivations. And if you draw the derivation tree, you will get one derivation tree for this and one derivation tree for the other leftmost derivation or rightmost, right? So the grammar is now said to be ambiguous. So why this is studied means in compiler design or while parsing, the ambiguous grammars are very troublesome in parsing the strings of the ambiguous grammar. That's why this is studied separately. So elimination of ambiguity and other things is out of our scope of this subject. So we are just going for the next topic, elimination of null productions. What is a null production? A production in which of this format, that is, the variable gives null string A to epsilon, A gives epsilon, is called a null production. Now a variable is called a nullable variable if that variable can derive null string in 0 or more steps. Star means 0 or more steps. So if you replace this A with some other production, let us say I have B, C, and B will replace something, C will replace something, and after some steps, it may be 5 steps, 10 steps or 1 step. If it is 1 step, there must be a production of this format, A gives epsilon. If it is more than 1 step, there must be something like this, but finally you will get epsilon. So why we want to eliminate null productions means, suppose in a derivation this A appears in sentential form, and because this A is deriving null string in some cases, not all cases, maybe in some cases it may derive some other string, but in some cases after say 10 steps you are getting null string. That means after following 10 substitutions, ultimately what you are getting is a null string which is not contributing anything to the final string. So 10 steps are wasted. In other words, I can say 10 steps are delayed to go to your string, from S to your string. So if
I can eliminate such type of situations, then examining a string, whether it is producing null string or not. If that is the case, then we'll change the grammar or we'll modify the grammar so that such situations will not arise. That is why we are eliminating null productions, right? So for eliminating null productions, first I have to find the nullable variables. How do I find nullable variables? I'll denote nullable variables with the NV in a grammar. So how to calculate means N0 is all those variables for which there is an epsilon production or null production, A to epsilon. Next, Ni is calculated from Ni minus 1. So Ni is Ni minus 1 union. New things will be added, new variables will be added to Ni. So previous nullable symbols, previous nullable variables union, some other new things will be added. How? If there is a production B to alpha where this alpha contains all nullable symbols in the previous step. In the previous step, I calculated all nullable variables. Suppose there is a new variable B for which on the right hand side you have all nullable variables from the previous step, then this B will be included into Ni. Now Ni will become set of new nullable variables. Now we'll repeat this calculation until Ni equal to Ni minus 1. So after that you can assign Ni to NV, that is set of nullable variables. Then once you find nullable variables, now you are ready to give a grammar which will be equivalent. You can now find a grammar equivalent to the grammar G. Now G is given for me. I want to find out G1. In G there are some nullable variables or null productions, nullable variables, but I want to find out a grammar G1 which is equal to L of G, which is equal to L of G and no null productions. But you have to always observe that L of G1 is equal to L of G minus epsilon. Because there are no null productions, you cannot generate null string in G1 because there are no null productions. All nullable variables are removed. So what I am getting is L of G1 is same as L of G except null string. There will be no null string in L of G1. So how do we do that? You can see P is the set of productions in G and P1 is the set of productions in P1. All other things are same, set of variables, terminals, starting, everything is same. Now look at this. What is P1? P1 is initialized to P except null productions, because I don't want null productions. Direct null productions are removed from P and the remaining things are added to P1. Then you take each production A to alpha in P, and every production A to alpha in P will give you new productions. What are the new productions? That I will tell you. You have to observe the null variables in alpha, that is on the right hand side of the production. Take each production and observe its right hand side. On the right hand side, if you have any nullable variables, then we eliminate one or more occurrences of nullable variables from alpha. Suppose alpha contains say 3 nullable variables. If there are 3 nullable variables, then what I do is I will take alpha and from alpha I will remove one nullable variable. Then you get some different string, let us say beta 1. Then A to beta 1 is added. Suppose there is another nullable variable, so then what I do is I will remove that second nullable variable from alpha. Suppose if I get beta 2, that will be added as A to beta 2. See, A to alpha is now giving many productions. A to alpha is the original thing which is available in P1, and in addition to that it is giving some other productions, a to beta 1, beta 2, up to beta k. So we have to eliminate nullable variables one at a time or more at a time. That means you can suppose there are three, you have to eliminate one variable at a time, two variables at a time, three variables at a time, and so on. If there are n variables, so what you have to do, you have to eliminate one at a time, two at a time, three at a time, four at a time, up to n at a time. Then you get different productions of E. Then once you do that, you are all done. So from the remaining things, if you get any, sometimes you get duplicate productions, sometimes you get trivial productions like A to A, B to B, then any null productions also you get sometimes. So all those things, if it is null production, you don't add at all, right? Even if you add, you can eliminate in this step, and you eliminate everything, then what you get is L of G1 is equal to L of G minus epsilon. Let us see an example. This is the grammar I have. So first I have to find out nullable variables. So N0 is A comma D. You can see A to epsilon is a production, so A is added into N0. Then D to epsilon is another production, so D is added. Your N0 is D. What is N1? N1 is Ni minus 1, that is N0 A comma D. Now you see A, D are available, you have to check for S. Now if you look at S to A, B, C, A is nullable, but B, C are not nullable. So S cannot be added, because if you look at the step Ni minus 1 union B to alpha, where alpha contains everything from the previous step, that is from N0. So if you look at, A is already added, so you need not look at this. B productions, if you see, B to BA, A is nullable, but B is not. And so this production also will tell you, you cannot add B. Now you go for C, C to alpha. Alpha now contains all nullable variables, that is from Ni minus 1, N0, A, D. So C to alpha, where alpha contains all nullable variables, then C is now added. So A, D, C. Now this is my N1. You need not check for D, it is already done. Now N2 is N1, that is A, C, D union new variables. If I observe, yes, A and C are okay, but B is not in N1, so it is not, S cannot be added. S to A, this will not give you anything, right? Then A is already added. Now I check for B, whether B can be added or not. B to BA, but B is not nullable. Then this will not tell you, you cannot add anything. And even though A and C are there, but now B is available, B is not nullable, so B cannot be added. C and D are already added. So what are my nullable variables? A, C, D. Now nullable variables are A, C, D. B and S are not nullable. Once you have nullable variables are calculated, now you can do this procedure. So what do I do? This is the grammar I have, and this is the nullable variables. So what I have to do is, first I have to add all productions of P into P1. So P1 will be initialized with all productions of P. Now you see S to A is added. Now from alpha, you have to eliminate all nullable variables. Now alpha is A, so nothing is added, because there are no nullable variables in alpha. So S to A is directly kept as it is. Now S to A, B, C, this is the original production from the grammar, so it is included, because it is non-null production, it is included. Next, in alpha, how many nullable variables are there? You can see A is nullable and C is nullable. So there are two nullable variables in this S to A, B, C. So you have to eliminate one at a time. For example, if I remove from A, B, C, if I remove this, I'll get B, C. So this is added. Now suppose from ABC, this is my alpha. From alpha, I have to eliminate one or more occurrences of nullable variables, right? So if I remove C, then I get AB. So AB is added. So I have eliminated one at a time. Now I eliminate two at a time because there are two nullable variables, A and C, at two positions, right? Position is also important. Now, if I eliminate two at a time, that is, I will eliminate both A and C from alpha. What do you get is B. So I got S to B. This is added. S to alpha is from the original grammar, and remaining things are by eliminating nullable variables from alpha. Now they will become S productions, right? So this is S. Now A to AB is directly added. Next, A to AA, A to AA is directly added. Now there is one nullable variable in this right hand side. That is only one. So I eliminate that one. What do you get? You get A. So A to A is added. Next, B to BA. Now in BA there is one nullable variable A. So that is eliminated. Then what do you get is B. So B to B. Next, B to BAB. No nullable variables. Then A to AB, AC. Look at this. Now your alpha is A to AB, AC. Now your alpha is, now I am working for this. B to AB, AC. Now your alpha is AB, AC. How many nullable variables? There are only two, but A at two positions is different. So this A is different and this A is different. That you have to observe. So how many? There are a total of three occurrences of nullable variables. Total of three. So what do I do is I eliminate one at a time. Suppose I eliminate the first A, then you get BAC. If I eliminate second A, I will get ABC. If I eliminate this C, then I get ABA. This by eliminating one at a time, one nullable variable from alpha. Now you see BAC, ABC, then AB. Next, I will take two at a time. So if I eliminate this A and this A, then what I get is BC. Suppose I eliminate this A and this C, A and C, first A and C, then what do you get? AA is eliminated. Now AC, what do you get? You get BA. You get BA. Now suppose second A and second C are eliminated, then what do you get? AB. A. Right. So I have got BC, BA, AB by eliminating two at a time. Now there are three. So if I eliminate three at a time, all A, A, C are eliminated. So you will be left with B. So that is this. Right. So this is your original production B to alpha. And from this alpha, by eliminating one or more occurrences of nullable variables, you have got all these things. Beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, up to some point. Right? So, this will tell you exactly what you have to do. Then C to AB are added, C to AD. Now there are two nullable variables. So, eliminate one at a time, you got D, A. And two at a time, you will get epsilon. If you don't add also, no problem, but later you can eliminate. Then D to AA, D to AB. Epsilon is eliminated. Now you can remove all trivial productions. For example, B to B is a trivial production. There is no point of having B to B, right? So you do that, and there is another trivial production B to B. So you can eliminate that and so on. So if you go for four step, you eliminate all null productions, then duplicate productions if there are any duplicate things. Like you see B to BA, then B to BA. So this is a duplicate production. So you can eliminate them, and you can eliminate any null productions, any trivial productions, and then what you get is this. I'm writing all the things at a time. So S, A, B, C, D. So this grammar is equal to this grammar and contains no null productions. That is L of G1 is equal to L of G. originally minus null string, but because this cannot contain null string, I say L of G1 is L of G. This is how you can eliminate null predictions. If S derives null string, that means S is a nullable variable, then this is what you get. Otherwise, this is what you get. Suppose you want your null string into G1, then you can always go for this. You can include S to epsilon as a special case. As a special case, except S to epsilon, all remaining null productions can be eliminated when you want this exactly. Then eliminating unit productions. Unit production is of this format A to B. Why is it called a unit production? Means length is 1. On the right hand side, you can see the length is 1 and that is only one variable on the right hand side. So, why these things should not be there? Means, for example, suppose you say in some production or in some derivation, you get like this alpha A beta. This is A. And suppose A to B is a production, then if this A is replaced, you get alpha B beta. That means you have one variable substituted with other variable, and this B can have, suppose this B will have C, then alpha C beta. See, three steps, but still only one variable, no progress in the derivation. Because such is the case, we don't want this at every step. If I want some progress towards the terminal string, then I don't want this type of production. So, eliminating unit productions. Now, there is another definition. You see, A derives B. Star means 0 or more steps. Then B is A derivable. A derivable means from A, if you start something from A, after some steps, you get B. Or after certain substitutions of the right hand side of the productions, you get another variable, that is B. Then we call B is A derivable. Right? B is A derivable. So, how to calculate derivables of a variable, given variable? Let us say A, variable A. A derivables, A0, A0 or AD of 0, A derivables at step 0. At step 0, if there is a direct unit production for A, then A to B, like A to B, then all those B's are added. That means B is A derivable, right? Next, A derivable of I is equal to the previous step and a new variable is included. If there is a production B to C and B is in the previous step, B is A derivable, and there is a production B to C, then C is A derivable. So, we are adding it to ADI, right? So, you repeat this until this is done. That is AD of M. Next. So, once you do this, whatever you get finally will be called as set of A derivables. So, set of A derivables is is assigned with the AD of I, right? So, this is how you can calculate a set of A derivatives. Next, once you have that, now you can, we are ready to eliminate the unit productions from a given grammar. Given grammar is G, we need to find out G1 with new set of productions and a known unit production. How do we do that? First, we have to compute the derivables of each variable A in G, then initialize P1 with all P, with all the productions in the original grammar except unit productions. Next, for each pair A comma B, that is for each pair where B is A derivable, for each, suppose A derivable has 5 variables, A can derive B, A can derive D, A can derive E, and so on. So, for each such pair, you take A and take its derivable. For each such pair, add A to beta, What is this beta? This beta is right hand side of B, which is non-unit production. All non-unit productions of B are added as the productions of A. That's it. So instead of going from A to B and B to beta, what we are doing? We are directly coming from A to beta. If you add this, then it is same as saying A derives B and B derives beta. Is nothing but A derives beta. That is that we are adding as a production. That's all, right? So after this, you remove any duplicates, any unit and trivial productions from P1, then you get your grammar where L of G1 is equal to L of G. Now let us remove unit productions from this grammar. Now first I have to calculate derivables of each variable. Now SD of 0, first I am calculating for SD. How do we calculate? At 0 step, B is added because S to B is a production, B is added. SD of 1 is SD of 0 union new things. Let us see whether I get some other new things. Now S0, we have B, so there is nothing you can add, A cannot be added, B is already available, the C cannot be added, now D cannot be added. No, let me say S to B, right? S to B. Now B to D is a production. B to D is a production. So D is added because you can come from S to B and B to D. So D is added. Now SD of 2. Now B and D are there. Now let me see the productions of D. D cannot give you any other unit variable. So you cannot add anything further. You cannot add anything further. So this is your SD of I equal to SD of I minus 1. And hence these are your S derivables. Next A derivables, AD of 0, A to C and A to D. So C and D are added. Then AD of 1, LC productions of C, no unit productions for C. And LC productions of D, no unit productions. So this will be your AD of 1. Now A derivables are C comma D. Now B derivables are D. Going in this manner, I'll get to B derivables, that is D, and D to nothing can be added. So this is B derivables. C derivables, C can derive no variable. So C derivables are phi. D derivables phi. Because from D you cannot derive any other variable, only variable. Here it derives a terminal and variable, not only one variable, right? So D derivables are phi. So once I have calculated the derivables for each variable, next I go for eliminating unit productions from this grammar. So this is my set of derivables. For each set, look at this, for each set you have to first add all productions of G into G1, all productions of G into G1 except unit productions. Then you have to take each pair A comma B, you have to take each pair A comma B, and B to beta should be added, right? Now a set of S derivables are B and D. So first I have to consider the pair S D comma B. First all productions are included, S to A B, A B A. All non-unit productions are included. S to B is not included because it's a unit production. Then A to A A B A. All non-unit productions of G are added into G1. Next, for the pair you have to consider now A comma B, where B is A derivable, SD comma B, not SD, S, to be exactly S, not SD. The pair I am considering now is S comma B, because B is S derivable. All non-unit productions of B should be added to the productions of S. Now what are the non-unit productions of B? B to BB, B to E. B to beta 1, B to beta 2. Now look at this. All non-unit productions of B are added to S. S to B beta, then S to E. This is for the pair S comma B. Now there is another derivable from S, that is S comma D. Right? Now S comma D, all non-unit productions of D. What are the non-unit productions of D? AB, then D to BA, then D to BD. These are added to S productions. S to AB, then S to BA, then S to BD. Right? So these are for S. Now for A, these are added from the original grammar, from this original grammar. Then A derivables are C and D. So what you have to consider now is A comma C, then A comma D. Consider A comma C. What are the non-unit productions of C? C to AB, C to AA. So those are added to A productions. Then non-unit productions of B, that is AB, BA, BD, are added to A. This is for this way. Similarly, you have to consider B comma D. B comma D. All non-unit productions of B are added to the productions of B. Then remaining things are just copied from the original grammar. Right? So this grammar G1 is now equal to L of G. And there are no unit productions. That is how you can eliminate the unit productions. Another variable or another grammar, E to E plus T R T, T to T star F R F, then F to E R A. What are E derivables? You can see E to T. So E derivables, E to T. Then T to F is there. So E can derive F also. So E to T, then T to F. And F cannot derive any variable. So these are E derivable pairs. And T derivables are T can derive F, T to F. F cannot derive anything. So these are T derivables and this is E derivables. So E comma T. So E to E plus T has added because of non-unit production. Now this is not added into new grammar, but in fact you have to go for non-unit productions of T. Non-unit productions of T are T to T star F. T to T star F is added to the productions of E. Similarly, non-unit productions of F. There are two non-unit productions for F. So, those are added to E. This is for this. Next, T to T star F. This is a non-unit production copied. Then, T comma F is a pair. And non-unit productions of F should be added to T. So, T to E, parenthesis within parenthesis, then T to E. This is for this. Next, non-unit productions of F are copied. So, this grammar is now equal to the given grammar and generates the same thing but without no unit productions. This is how you can eliminate unit productions. Then another thing is live variable. What is a live variable? A variable A in a CFG is live if A derives X. What is this X? X is a string of terminals. If it contains terminals and variables, then we call it sentential form, not a string. String means string of terminals or string of alphabet symbols. So usually X, Y, U, V, W, all those things will always denote the string of terminals, right? Now, how do we find out live variables in a grammar? Why? Because to have grammar means to generate strings. Suppose if there is a string which does not generate some string, then that variable is not useful for me. And hence, what we should do is, first we should find out all variables which can derive some string. A can derive some string after certain number of steps. Then only I call that variable A as live. Right? So, how do we find out live variables in a given grammar? How do we find out L0 is A such that A to X is a production? That means on the right hand side of the variable, we have only terminals including epsilon. Then we call that variable A is live, L0. And the next step Li minus 1. And B to alpha, so all those variables in which the right hand side, it has some production, B has some production, in which the right hand side contains everything from Li minus 1, everything from Li minus 1, that is all variables which are live, and there are some terminals. Terminals will always give you some symbol, terminal symbol. So, everything on the right hand side, either it's a mixture of either terminals, and you may have variables which are live in previous step. Then we include this B, because B can generate some string in alpha. If there are variables which are already live, then B becomes live, including some terminal symbols. Then we include B into set of live variables, and you repeat this until Li equal to Li minus 1. Once this is done, then what you get finally is the set of live variables in the given grammar. Let us take the grammar. This is the grammar I have. Now I will go for live variables in this grammar. Because of this S to AB, where this is X, all terminals. So S is live. Now because of A to AB, A is live. Because of this also A is live, but don't matter, A is live. B you cannot consider live now at this point. C you can consider as live because there is only terminals. Then D you cannot consider as live because there is some variables, and E also you cannot consider. So at L0, that means at step 0, S, A and C can give you some string of terminals or some string, give you some string, right? Now L1 is L0 union, L0 union. Now S, A and C are already there, now I will observe B. B to B, B. Now B is not live in L0, so you cannot add B. C is already added. Let me check for D. D contains two variables A and B, and even though A is live, B is not live in L0, B is not available in L0, and similarly B is also not available in L0, so D cannot be added. Now let me see E. If you look at this E to AC, A is live, C is live, or even if you look at this E to AAC, A is live, C is live. That means this can give you some string, C can also give you some string, and A is a terminal. So, combinedly you can get a string, and hence E can be added. So, your L1 is S, A, C, E. Now, your L2. SACE L1 union. Now, what are missing? You can check for B and you have to check for D. If you look at B, B to B, B. B is not live so far. Then this also B is not live so far. Right? So B cannot be added. You cannot add B. Now D to A, B. A is live but B is not live. So you cannot get a string. Similarly, A, B, B. And B is not live. So D can also give. Cannot give you any string. So, nothing new can be added, and hence L2 equal to L1. So, you can stop your computation, and the set of live variables in your grammar are S, A, C, E. That means only these variables can give you some string, any string. It can be anything. It can be AB, it can be AAR, it can be some other string, but they will give you some strings. So if you start your derivation in a grammar, if S is live, then only your grammar is useful, or your grammar can generate something. If S is not live, suppose S turns out to be not live, then if you start from S a derivation, you don't get any terminal string. So if S is not live, that grammar is not useful for us, because S cannot derive anything, right? So this is set of live variables. Now a variable is not live, then it is said to be a dead variable and can be eliminated from the grammar, because when it is dead, when it is not live, means it is not giving you any string. When it is not giving any string for me, so in any derivation you won't get any string using that variable, and hence I will remove that dead variable from the grammar, because there is no use of having that variable in the grammar and the productions containing that variable. So how to remove? Just remove all the productions corresponding to the dead variable or variables, and remove all productions in which the right hand side contains at least one dead variable. So on the right hand side of the productions, if dead variable is available for any other live variables, then you can remove it, right? Now look at this. I am going to eliminate the dead variables from this grammar. Dead variables are B, comma D. Now look at this. S to ABC is not added, because in ABC there is a dead variable B, and hence S to ABC is not added. And S to AB is added, and S to BA is added, because A is live. Then A to AB is added, A to BA is added, A to AA is added, but A to BB is not added, because B is dead. When B is dead, this production, even if you use, you don't get any string, because B is dead. So this production is not useful for me. That is why this is eliminated. And all productions of B are eliminated, because they are not giving, because B itself is dead. B cannot give you anything. So B itself is eliminated. Then C productions. C to AC is added, AB is added, AC is added, CD is added, because all the things available in right hand sides of all these productions are live. So they are added. Now D productions are not added, because D is dead. So there is no point of having D production. There is no use in having D productions in the grammar. Next, E. E to AC is added, because A and C are live. BC is removed, because B is dead. Then E to AAC, everything is live, and hence this is your grammar containing only live variables. All are live, containing live variables and no other dead variables. This is how you can eliminate a set of live variables, dead variables. You can eliminate dead variables. Next. Reachable variables. Variable is reachable if this is the case. That means if you start from S, you can reach A in some derivation, any derivation. You start from S, then you can reach A after certain number of steps. So the variable A is now reachable from S, because our derivations will start from S. Every variable should be reachable from S. That means they will appear in some derivation. Right? So up to some point. So how do we calculate the set of reachables? The first reachable variable for me is S, because I start my derivation from S. So S is reachable. R0 is equal to S. Then what is RI? RI equal to RI minus 1 union. You take the reachable variables and take their right hand side. On the right hand side of the productions of reachable variables, there is some other variable, and if that is the case, you include that variable A include that variable A into reachables, because B is reachable in previous step. Now, using productions of B, I can go to another variable. If I use productions of B, they can be replaced with this. That means A is reachable, so A is added to the set of reachables. So, this is how I get the reachables. Now, what happens? Repeat step 2 until Ri equal to Ri minus 1. So, you keep on adding the new things by doing in this manner, and if the previous step and current step are equal, then you stop your computation and declare the set of reachables. Now look at an example. This is the grammar I have taken. Let me see the reachables. R0 is yes, R1 is S2AB, S2BA. So A is reachable. The variable A is reachable. So this is my R1. R2 equal to SA. Now I see the productions of A. A2, no other variable is reachable from A. And so I close the computation. So R1 equal to R2. So my reachables are S, A. These are reachable variables. So what are dead variables for me? All productions of reachable variables can be eliminated from the grammar. So when the variable becomes non-reachable, that means S and A are reachable, but other variables, now I have some other variables C and E which are not reachable, or I say unreachable. So now there is no use of containing the unreachable variables in the grammar, because you start from S, you cannot reach the variable C, or you cannot reach the variable E, and hence there is no meaning of having the productions of C and E, even though they are giving you some strings, but I am unable to reach to C or to E so that I can use them in some derivation, and hence they are unreachable and not useful for me, right? So I can now eliminate unreachable variables. How I can eliminate? Just eliminate all the productions involving the unreachable variables and all other things. Then this can be eliminated from the grammar. Now this is my grammar that contains all reachable variables or no reachable variables in the grammar. This grammar and this grammar are equal, but this grammar contains unreachable variables. This grammar contains only useful things, right? Or unreachable variables, right? A useless variable. What is a useless variable in the grammar? A variable is useful in a grammar if this is the case. What is the meaning of this? You are starting a derivation from S, or starting a derivation from S, and you are reaching a terminal string X, and in the path of reaching from S to X, in the process of deriving the string X, a variable A is used. So if your variable A is used in at least one derivation, of a string, then A is called useful. Now A is useful. If this is not the case, then A is not useful. That is, A is useless. So how do we find out the useless variables in a grammar? How do we find out a variable that is either not live or not reachable is a useless variable? Look at this. So that variable should be live. First I'll go for useful variable. When you go for useful variable, it should be both live and reachable. When a variable is either not live, that means it cannot derive something, or it is not reachable. Sometimes it may derive something, but it is not reachable from S. Then, in both these cases, in either this is true or this is true,
then we say that the variable is useless.
So whenever there is a variable in the grammar which is not live or which is not reachable, then we call it to be useless, and you can remove all those useless variables from the grammar without changing the language of the grammar. Eliminating useless variables from a context-free grammar G. So how do we find out? First you have to find out the dead variables in the grammar G and eliminate the dead variables. So first dead variables. So you know how to call a dead variable. That is a variable that is not live is a dead variable, and you can eliminate. So you get G1 after eliminating dead variables. Then you take G1 and eliminate the unreachable variables from the grammar G1. Then what you obtain is G2. So a CFG G2 obtained after step 2. Remember, whatever you get now will be a grammar which is equal to the original grammar G and it contains no useless variables. Right? That is how you can eliminate the useless variables from a grammar. Example. Look at this grammar. Live variables. First I am calculating live variables. So A is live. B is live. A is live because it is giving some string. B is live because it is giving some string. Now because A and B are live, because of this, B is live and alpha contains all live variables. So S is also live. So S is live, A is live, B is live. C cannot be live because even though A is live, C cannot give you something. Because of this C to AC, C to CA. So my live variables are this and dead variable is eliminating dead variable C. Dead variable is C. So eliminating dead variable and its productions. So what do you get? S to ABC is eliminated because it contains some dead variable. S to BAB, then A to AA, then A to AA. BAC is not copied because there is a dead variable. So this is your A productions. Now B to BBB and B to A are added. Now this is the grammar. This is the grammar which is equal to the given grammar and no dead variables, right? Then step 2 is you have to take this grammar, not the original grammar. You take this grammar and then you have to calculate unreachable variables. Now if you look at the unreachable variables in this grammar, you see, what are unreachables? S is reachable in this grammar G1. S is reachable. Then B is reachable because from S to B, A, B production. B is reachable. Now B to B, 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 A. So these are reachables. What are unreachables? A is unreachable. A is unreachable. So now you can eliminate productions involving unreachable variables, right? So what happens now? S productions and B productions are copied. S productions, B productions. No A productions because A is not reachable. So this is the grammar which is equal to the given grammar, that is this grammar and containing all useful variables or no useless variables. This grammar and the given grammar are equal. This is how you can eliminate useless variables from a given grammar. One thing you have to observe here is, what we are doing is, to eliminate useless variables, first we are finding dead variables and obtaining G1. We are eliminating dead variables, then get G1, take G1 as input and eliminate unreachable variables and get G2. Order of these steps is very important because if you do in reverse order, the results may be correct, may not be correct. Sometimes they will not give you correct results. So this order is very, very important. This you have to keep in mind. For example, you see this grammar. In this grammar, let us say I reverse the order. First reachables I calculate. S is reachable, A is reachable, B is reachable. Now C is not reachable. So what I am doing is I am eliminating the productions of C and any other thing which contains that C, right? So now S, A, B, these are the things that after eliminating unreachable variables. Now from this I calculate live variables. You see live variables are S is live because of BB, then A is also live, right? And B cannot be live, right? So these are my live variables. S and A are live. Because of this B cannot be live. Now this is live variables, and now eliminating dead variable B. Now suppose I eliminate the dead variable B, what happens? You see the productions of B are eliminated and S to BB, this is not copied. This is not copied because B is dead variable. So S to BB and A to BB. Now look at this grammar. If you look at this grammar can give you only one string, and that string is S to BB. Sometimes it may give you more than one string, but the point here is to look at this. This production or this variable A to BB is useless for me, because if I start derivation from S, what I get is B, but A is not reachable. Now it is becoming unreachable because a dead variable is removed. And hence, you always remember that the order of these steps is very important. So first you have to find out dead variables and then eliminate them, followed by unreachable variables should be eliminated. If you reverse the order, you will not get the correct results. So that is that you have to keep in mind, right? So it's time for a short break. So let's have a break for 5 minutes and then we'll continue. Welcome back.
There are two normal forms for a given context examiner. First one is Chomsky normal form. So a CFG is in Chomsky normal form if all the productions will be in one of these two formats. Either it will be something like this or it will be something like this. Any production you take on the right hand side, you should have either two variables or only whatever. Only these two variations are allowed.
Apart from this, anything is there, then you can call it as you can say that it is not in Chomsky.
And this is the only special case. So FK epsilon is which is not in this two format, but this is allowed only when epsilon is in the grammar, only when your grammar contains null. And one more condition is, if this is the case, S2 epsilon, then S should not appear on the right hand side of any position. If it appears, then you have to do this modification. S should be representing S1, and all in other positions, wherever you see S, S1 should be replaced, right? And then just go for S, S as N, now NUS is introduced with S to epsilon and S2 alpha 1 to alpha m, where your alphas are the previous S production. Your alphas are the previous S production, right? This is only when your language contains, or your language of the grammar contains null string. If it is not there, you don't worry about this condition. Converting a given grammar into CNF. How do you convert? How do we convert? So, first step is we eliminate null productions. Then we eliminate unit productions. Productions. Now after doing this, if we have to first eliminate from G, you have to take G, then eliminate null productions, you get G1. So you take G1, and from G1 you eliminate unit productions, then you get G2. So you take G and give input to step 1, you get new one G1, then you give input to step 2, then you give you will get G2, you give input to step 3. In step 3, what we are doing is, if there is there are some productions in G2 which are not in CNF, then what we will do is, we will convert all RHS which is not in CNF into this format. What is this format? B1, B2, BK. What is B? BI is a variable. That means on the right hand side, we are making everything as a variable. We are making every right hand side as a variable, which is not in CNF, right? So how do we do that? We just introduce new variables by introducing new variables into the grammar. Soon we will see how we can do that, right? Where each BI is a variable. So you can introduce variables, new variables, and then you can do that. Now step 4 says, if any production after step 3 has more than two variables on the right hand side, then what we do? We convert that into two variables. So more than two variables, we make it into two variables. How? B1, and all remaining variables are made into single variable. And what is this Y1? Y1 is B2, Y2. Now it becomes 2. Now what is Y2? B3, Y3. So when you have more than two variables on the right hand side, then we are making it into a series of productions which will contain only two variables. Once you do that, after step 4, you will have a grammar which is in CNF. Let's take an example, then it will be easy for you. This is the grammar I have. First, I have to eliminate null productions. So, my nullable variables are A and D, and this is what I have got after eliminating null productions. So, you know how to eliminate null productions from the grammar. So, nullable variables are A and B, and we have eliminated them. So this is my G1. So this G1 will become input for step 2, G2. So eliminating unit productions. Now what are the unit productions? Only one I have. So S derivable is C. There are no C derivables, there are no D derivables, there are no A derivables. Only S derivables, and that is only C. So, all non-unit productions of C are now included. What are non-unit productions of C? A, C, E. So, these two are included into S. So, now what are your S productions?
your S productions are this along with this and the remaining production. Remaining productions of A, C, D are now available. Right? Now look at this. On the right hand, in step 3, what it says on the right hand side, if the right hand side is not in GNF, that is two variables or one terminal is allowed, apart from that nothing is allowed. Now look at this. So step 3 says you have to convert them into all right hand sides into all variables on the right hand side. If it is not the case and not in GNF, you convert them into all variables format, right? So you just see, this is all variables, all variables, all variables, all variables, all variables, and this is in CNF. This is in CNF one terminal. Now S2AC is not in CNF and one terminal, one variable. So what I am doing is, this terminal A is replaced with a variable XCA and C is already a variable. So XCAC. Now XA is the new variable that has been introduced. So I am just making XA to A. Right? So this is have done. So I made them into, on the right hand side, this is not in GNF and doesn't contain some mixture of terminals and variables. So I am making it into all variables. Similarly, A to AB is now A to XA, XB, two variables. XA is already introduced. So for XB, I am introducing XB to B. And this will take into this form. So XA, E, XB. XA and XB are already available. But don't use the already available names. Even though S2A is available, you cannot use S here. If you use, you will get different productions and different grammar, right? So don't use that, you just always introduce new variable. Now C2AC, so you get XAC. Then C2A is in required format, so I don't need any change. Then D2ADA will be replaced with this, BDB is replaced with this, then AA is replaced with this, then BB. BB is replaced with XB, XB. Right? These are the new productions. Right? Now, step 4 says you have to restrict the right hand side to two variables. So, step 4 is restricting the right hand sides to two variables. So, what we do? When something is not in CNF, we will convert it into CNF. See, this is what I have. And this is not in CNF, so what I am doing is AACD is now replaced with AT1. Now what is T1? Is ACD. ACD. 3, you will get 3 variables, but I don't want 3. So AT2. What is T2? Is CD. Now, this is equal to AACD, but only thing is we have a series of variables and production. S2 AT1. T1 when replaced with AT2, you get S2A. A, T2 replaced with CD, you get AACD. Instead of having one production, I am having a sequence of productions. And then this will be S2A, U1, because I have used T, I am using U. A, U1, then U1 is CD. Then S2A, V1, V1 is AC. So this is for this. Then the remaining things are already in CNF. S2A, C, CD, two variables, one terminal, two. A to XA, XB is already available, but for this A to XCA, XB, three variables, so I made it to two variables by introducing new variable W1. Similarly, this is already available. When you take D productions, you use D productions, so XCA, DB, there are three variables, so I have to make it into two. D to XA, Y1. Y1 is DXA, DXA. Similarly, XB, XB, Z1, then Z1 to DXB, DXB, right? Then the remaining productions of D are in CNF. Now this is your grammar. After step 4, if you observe, your grammar is this, all productions. Now this grammar, with all these productions, these are from step 3. These are from step 3, just for illustration purpose, I have shown them. So this is converted into this, right? So, this is your
grammar now and is in GCNF, that is Chomsky normal form, and equal to the original grammar or given grammar. This is how it enters.
Let us see one more example. Now I am taking grammar to simplify the explanation. I am taking grammar with very less interactions. Now only one nullable variable, that is S, right? So after eliminating null variables, what I am getting, S to A, S A, and because S is nullable, I got A A, then B S B, and B B, then A B, epsilon. So this epsilon, I am allowing this epsilon because of this is already a special case. I will tell you later how I can do it, right? Then A to, I will handle this case separately. For now, I just include it, right? So then A to A A A, then B to B B B. This is after eliminating null productions. Then if I eliminate unit productions, then there are no unit productions here, you can see, so no point. So you take this grammar and right hand side you have to restrict the number of variables. So A, S, A, all are variables. So X, A, then X, A is replaced with X, A to A, and X, B, B is replaced with X, B. So X, A, S, X, A, A means X, A, X, A, then X, B, S, X, B, X, B, X, B, A, B, this special case. Then X, A, A, this is as it is because it is already in CNF, and this one, and this is already in CNF. Now these two are newly introduced. Next, right hand side, after this, right hand side, I have to restrict with two variables. So you can see X, A, S, X, A is replaced with X, A, T1. Now T1 is S, X, A. Similarly, the other things. Now look at this. All these are now replaced after fourth step. And in this example, if you look, epsilon is in L of G. This is a special case you can allow. Now, because epsilon is in L of G, S to epsilon is allowed, but S is appearing on the right hand side of some productions. Look at this. Look at this. S is on the right hand side, S is on the right hand side. If it is not on the right hand side, you need not do anything, you can just have it S to epsilon. But because S to epsilon is in the grammar and S is appearing on the right hand side of anything, if it doesn't appear, you can simply have S to epsilon in the grammar. But because it is appearing, because even though it is not in CNF, it is allowed. But when this is allowed, S should not appear on the right hand side. If it appears, what we are doing? We are just replacing S with S1. Look at this. Wherever I have S, that is replaced with S1. Right? Now, in the grammar, S is replaced with S1. Now, what should I do? S to epsilon should be introduced. Look at this. S to epsilon is now introduced. This S is new S, not old S. And all productions of S1, these are the productions of S1, should be included to the productions of S. Look at this. All the productions of S are included to S1. Previous S. Previous S. This is your previous S. They are included to S1. Right? Right? Now this is your S1. So this grammar is in CNF and equal to L of G including epsilon. Right? Just I have given this example just for this. Otherwise, you can stop after fourth step. Next is Grebeck normal form. This is a more general normal form. You see, a CFG G is in Grebeck normal form if all productions are in the form A to A alpha, that is one terminal followed by what is alpha? Any number of variables including 0. That is, you can have one terminal, only one terminal, or on the right hand side, only one terminal or one terminal followed by any number of variables, any number of variables. And this is the same case if you have S to epsilon, that is epsilon is in the grammar, then S to epsilon is allowed. If S to epsilon is allowed, another condition is that S should not appear on the right hand side. If it appears, then you do this, right? That is same with the CNF format. Now, for converting a given grammar into Grabac normal form, this is a little bit lengthy procedure. First, you require two procedures. What are those two procedures? The two procedures are, first procedure is, if there is a production of this format A to B beta, that means the productions of A are starting with a variable B, starting with a variable B, right? If you don't want this A productions to start with B, then what you have to do is, this should be replaced with, this should be replaced with A to alpha 1 beta, alpha 2 beta and alpha m beta. Then what are these alphas? These alphas are the right hand sides of variable B. So, whenever you don't want A productions to start with B, then you can remove this by introducing these productions of A. That means simply B is replaced with its RHS of the productions of B, alpha 1 beta, alpha 2 beta, then alpha m beta, right? If you do this, then your A productions will not start with variable B, right? For example, look at this. If this is the set one of the A productions, let us suppose that A has this production and these are the B productions. Then what should I do? I don't want this B as the beginning variable for the set of A production. Then what should I do? Just take this and replace this with this. What are this? AB and ABCB. ABCB. Then BB. Then ABCB. This is from your origin. Then AAB. Then A, B, C. This is A, B, C, right? This is your procedure 1. Procedure 2. This is also called as elimination of left recursion. Purely saying elimination of immediate left recursion. Here we are just showing only immediate left recursion because we are not finding the left recursion continuously, right? So, if there is, you just observe, this is elimination of left recursion. If there is a variable A in which some of its right hand sides are starting with the same variable, that is, the productions of A starting with A, A to A alpha 1, A to A alpha 2, to A to A alpha, and there are certain some set of productions in which the right hand side of A is starting with the same variable, and there are some other things where their beginning does not contain A. So, the first symbol in beta 1, beta 2 or beta n is not A. It could be some other thing, but we don't mind. There are some productions in which the right hand side always starts with A. So, this is the set. This is called left recursion, where a variable right hand side, the productions of a variable starts with the same variable. Then we call there is left recursion in A. So, there is left recursion in A. Now, I don't want this left recursion in the set of A production. So, I have to eliminate. How do I eliminate? If this is the case, that means the set of A productions, some of them are having A and some of them are not beginning with A. Then, what can I do is, I can replace these set of A productions. Replace, I am saying replace, not addition. So in place of this set of A productions, I will place these productions, right? I remove this and I introduce this. What are they? A to beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, beta n. What are this? From your A, where beta 1 to beta n will not start with A. So there will be no left regression, right? Beta 1, beta n, beta 1, z, beta n. Then beta 1, z. The z is a new variable I am introducing, which is not already in the grammar. Which is not already in the grammar. Beta 1, z, beta 2, z, beta n, z. So z is a new variable I am introducing. Right? Next. What is this z? A new variable. So you have to specify what are the productions of z. Now z productions are z to alpha 1. What is alpha 1? On the right hand side of A, there are something which is starting with A. You just accept that A, all the remaining symbols of the production on the RHS, right? A to Z to alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha m, alpha 1 Z, alpha 2 Z, alpha Z. This set of A productions will be equal to this. So this is now replaced with this. There is no left recursion in A productions, but still these two set of productions will be equivalent to this. Right? Now example. Just look at this example. A to A B, A to A A B, and so on. Now look, there are some A productions which are starting with A and some things which are not starting with A. So this is your alpha 1, A alpha 1, A alpha 2, this is alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, right? Then this is beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, beta 4, beta 5. Now this can be replaced with, they are replaced with A2, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, beta 4, beta 5. They are copied. Beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, beta 4, beta 5. Then beta 1 Z, beta 2 Z, beta 3 Z, beta 4 Z, and so on. Z productions are alpha 1. Except this A, remaining thing is alpha 1. Alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. Right, only alpha 3. Alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. Then alpha 1 Z, that is BZ, alpha 2 Z, alpha 3 Z. So this set of productions are equal to having this set of productions for A with new variable introduced, that is A. Converting a conditional grammar into GNF. What are the steps? The steps are eliminate null productions and unit productions, then convert the productions which are not in GNF into the form. That means on the right hand side, what I am doing, just like GNF, I am making everything on the right hand side into a variable when it is not in GNF into this format. Then third step is rename the variables A1 to AN. Variables starting with S equal to A1. So you start with S equal to A1 and the remaining things you can use anything. There is no importance for the order, but only thing is S should be renamed with A1. Then fourth production is productions which are not in GNF. If they are in GNF, you leave them as it is, don't do anything. If they are not in GNF, if there is a variable AI, you are renamed variables now. Any variable will have A1, A2, A3 up to AN. If there is a variable AI, then if it is not in DNF, then you have to make it into this format. What is this format? AI to AJ beta. That means AI productions should start with AJ beta, where J is greater than 9. That means all A1 productions, maybe either they should be in GNF, or if they are not GNF, it should start with A2 or A3 and so on. Suppose you take A5 on the right hand side, either it should be like this, or it should be A6, or it should start with A7 or A10 or anything. But this is the condition. Right? How do we do this? How do we do this? First we will take A1 production and we will see if anything starts with this format, it is okay. If it doesn't start with that format, then what is the only possibility? It may start with a variable, but the first variable we have used is A1. So what happens now? Either it starts with A1 of this format, or it may start with A1, or it may start with A2 or A5. If it starts with A2, this is fine. A1 to A2 alpha is allowed. But suppose this A1 starts with A1, what should we do? Just apply elimination of left recursion procedure. That is, apply procedure to 2A1 productions, right? To start with A1. So apply procedure to 2A1 productions if it is necessary. Otherwise, then you go to A2 productions. If they are in this format, okay. If they are in this format, okay. If they are not in that format, then A2 may start with A1. When A2 starts with A1, you just apply procedure 1. Then you can get A2 productions will start with A2 or A5 or anything. If by the end of this, what you get is A2 productions may start with a variable whose index is 2 or higher, if you do this. Right? So A2 productions now will have A2. Then if that is the case, you apply procedure 2. Then immediate left recursion elimination. Then you get A2 productions into this form or this form, right? So this should be continued up to AN-1. Once you do this, what happens after step 4? Up to A1 to AN-1, everything will be in this format: A to A alpha or A to A J beta, where J is greater than I. Fifth step is, you take AN productions and convert the AN productions into this form. What is this form? AN to AN gamma, because greater than AN is not possible. Right? Into this form. When you convert this into this form, apply procedure 2. Because if AN starts with say AN-2, then you can apply procedure 1. So that it will not start with the AN-1 and so on. If you continuously apply procedure 1 to AN, then you will get AN to AN beta. Now to avoid this AN, you can apply procedure 2 because it eliminates left recursion. So once you do that, all AN productions will be converted into GNF. That means after step 5, all productions of AN will be in GNF. Now you start with AN-1, then go to AN-2, then go to A1. So that all production, apply procedure 1. You can apply procedure 1 if necessary to make AN-1, AN-2 up to A1 into GNF format. Then step 7 says, while you are doing this, intermediately when you apply procedure 2, Z productions will be introduced, new variables. So that ZI can be converted into GNF by using procedure 1. This should be procedure 1. Then at the end of step 7, what happens is all productions will be in GNF. So this may be a little bit confusing, but if you look at the example, it's going to be easy. Now look at this. What I am doing is, this is the grammar I am taking. Then first what I will do is, I have to eliminate null productions and unit productions. So after eliminating null productions and unit productions, this is what I have got. This is the grammar. If you want, you can refer to previous steps. Right? So So I got this. Then step 2 is on the right hand side, I have to make all variables if it is not in GNF. Now this is not in GNF, e to e plus t. So I have introduced a new variable x. E x t. What is x? X to plus. Terminal plus is replaced with variable x. So e to e x t. E to t star f not in GNF. So this terminal star is replaced with y. Okay. Then e to this I am keeping as is. I am not replacing this because in GNF my production can start with a terminal. So I am not replacing this left parenthesis, but I am replacing this right parenthesis to a variable. In doing so, instead of, you can replace this with a variable and make all variables, but I am just minimizing the number of steps that are required. So at first I am making one terminal. So I am keeping the first terminal as it is. I am not making any changes. Now this cannot be a terminal, so I am replacing it with z and z to right parenthesis, right? Then e. This is already in GNF, right? Then t to t star f. Star is in earlier I have replaced star with y. So t y f. Then this and e. Then f to this e. This is replaced, right? So this is your step 2. Step 3. Step 3 says you have to rename variables with s equal to a1. S is starting variable. Now see a1. E is starting variable, a1. Then see I am replacing with e with a1, t with a2. So e is a1, t is a2, then f is a3, then a4 is x. X is a4, y is a5, then z is a6. Now I have a1 to a6, 6 variables. So e to ext, that means e is a1, a1, x is a4, a1, a4, t is a2, right? So I have just replaced all the variables with new names. New names, a1, a2, a3, up to now what is step 4? Step 4 is you have to convert a1 to an minus productions such that ai to aj alpha where j is greater than I. That is what you have to do. Now look at a1 productions. You have to always start from a1 productions. Look at a1 productions. This is in GNF and this is in GNF. So these two will not be touched. So no modifications to these two productions. And this is starting with A2. So AI to AJ alpha where J should be greater than I. So this is okay, but this is not okay. A1 should not start with A1. So what should I do? Now I will apply procedure 2 to this A1 productions. When I apply procedure 2, these set of productions will be replaced with this A1 to beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, beta 1 z, beta 2 z, beta 3 z. Next, z1. Because this is for A1, I placed z1. So, z1 to alpha 1, A4, A2, then alpha 1, z1. So this is one. Next I take A2 productions. Look at A2 productions. A2 productions are starting with A2. So these are A2 productions. This is in the required format. This is in the required format. This should not start with A2. So I am applying procedure 2. Then what happens? These are A2 productions and these are Z2 productions. Then A3, A4, A5 requires no modification. What are the A3, A4, A5? See A3, it's already in GNF, so I'm not making any modifications. A4 is in GNF, A5 and A6, so they are all in GNF, right? So they don't require any modification. A6 productions, A6 is also in GNF, so no modification. then now you have to continue from an minus 1, an minus 2 up to a1. So a5, a4, a3, a3 is in GNF. If you go for a2, these will not require any modifications. Then a1 productions, no modifications. Then now there are some other a1 productions. If you look at some other a1 productions, look at some other A1 productions. Where are the A1 productions? See, A1 productions. Step 4, after step 4. You see A1 production is starting with A2 and A2. Right? So, what I am doing is I am applying procedure 1. I am applying procedure 1 to A1 productions. I am applying procedure 1 to A1 productions. Now, this should be replaced with A2. What are A2 productions? These are A2 productions. So, just your this A2 will be replaced with right hand sides of A2. So, A2 will be replaced with this. So, A2 is this replaced. A5, A3. So, A5, A3. Then, next one is left parenthesis A1, A6, Z2. Left parenthesis A1, A6, Z2. It is here. A1, Z2. Then remaining A5, A3 is here. And so on. So, all right hand sides of A2s are used to replace this A1 productions. This A2 in A1 productions. Then, all ZI productions should be done. So, where is I have introduced Z2 and Z1. So, procedure 1 is used to remove this variables A4 from Z1 and A5 from Z2. So, apply procedure 1 and you will get all Z2 productions and Z1 productions into the required format. Right? Now, you can see they are replaced. So, what you get now is you just write all the productions in one place, and what I have done is A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, A6 are replaced back to their original names. That is, A1 is now E, A2 is now T, and so on. If you don't rename also, it doesn't matter, you get the new grammar. So, this is my grammar which is in GNF and equal to the given grammar. Now, you can see every production will start with the terminal, followed by variables. All other are variables. You can see that everything is now starting with terminal followed by zero or more variables. So, this is in GNF and equal to your given grammar. So, this is your GNF. Similarly, you can, I have given another example, you can go for that. Right.